Today, the technology is available. There are researches happened which had come for applications where they try to handle the data with the finest cell. Like, you know, maybe if some of you are teaching GIS, you may be knowing quatri. We try to put the data in a quatri form in such a way wherever homogeneity is there, you don't further divide. Whenever you have a smaller cell, you further divide into quadrant, quadrant, so that you can store the data to the resolution you need it. Quatri is very good as far as handling the thematic maps are concerned, not for remote sensing data directly, for handling it. Also, there are run length encoding, value point encoding. These are all methods where people try to adapt for storing the thematic data and processing the thematic data. Good algorithms are available where they try to store so that one can even in raster go for the smallest or the finest resolution possible and then handle it. But only thing is, if you are a user of a GIS package, you should know whether your GIS tool will it handle it. Because there are packages which give those kind of storage mechanisms, there are packages which don't. So which tool you are using, based on that, whether if it supports a quatri model, finest resolution it can handle, or whether it has some encoding methods, you can still handle the finest resolution data without any difficulty. One is raster, next is vector. Vector is nothing, as I said, fundamentally x comma y is important for us. When you put it in an ordered form of x, y, you generate a line. And I generate a line, I go and close it, I get generate an area. How do we define an area? If you go in mathematics, how do we define this? We have something called a Jordan curve. We say a curve which closes, a closed curve which has an interior and a boundary. So whenever you have a curve and you have an interior area, naturally it becomes a polygon. Okay? So it can have a point, it can be a line, it can be a polygon. As I said, the basic units in vector which can be handled. And you know, when we handle it, again try to handle point, line and polygon. It's a very good model. You need not worry about the resolution of the pixel. But the problems are, whenever you are on raster, very easy to analyze, very easy to process, because as I said, whatever is happening in image processing, we can pull it and use it in raster. Vector has its own theory. Computational geometry plays an important role when you want to handle the data in a vector mode in a GIS. Okay? So analysis, processing, they are not as simple as you do in raster. Okay? So points we put, lines we try to put, polygons we try to put, three major categories whenever you handle the data in a vector representation. Easy to store, accuracy can be very high, but difficult to process. So when you come to the storage in a vector model, the point that comes into picture is, the first thing is, how do we store this? See, raster, you cannot do it. You put a grid, you store it. Only thing is, I said quatri people can follow, or run length encoding people can follow, value point coding they can follow to compress the storage. But in vector, what we do, you take the data, you simply try to store it. Simply like this, I take the point data, position, give the value x, y, the ID 10. Then, you know, I give a line, x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, I store it as an arc, give the value. Okay, one can store the polygons. So this kind of structure only people started storing in vector in the initial stage to store the data. But what we all had found as a limitations, if you look at the data, you look at there is a common boundary between 63 and 64. You can just see there is a common boundary between two polygons. We are only storing two polygons here, and there is a common boundary between both of them. So what we try to store? We store 63 as one entity, 64 as another entity with a common boundary between them. So kya hota hai? The common boundary is stored twice now. And you know, even if stored twice, doesn't matter. But you know, a person who would have digitized, who he would have done the same vertices, what is the guarantee? See, he would have done this once. He would have done this common boundary again. So you know, when you zoom it, you will see this common boundary may not be sitting one over the other. This may happen. So what, see, of course, many tools support still that kind of storage. So the first one is, we call this as non-topological structure, where you store as you see. You do not bother whether I have to share a common boundary. That kind of model was called as a kind of a non-topological data structure to handle the vector data. Then came the topology into mind. So when topology came, what they did, in fact, you know, topology, the contribution, topology is a theory in mathematics where we try to work on the relations between geometric objects. Because, you know, if you go a little deeper in topology, what it does is, topological relations are invariant. They don't change whenever you do a skewing, whenever you enlarge it, whenever you shrink it. See, I am in front of you. Whatever happens to this room, whether they rotate it, whether they enlarge it, or whether you shrink it, that's a relation, a topological relation. It is invariant whenever you do scaling or rotation or, you know, enlargement, etc. That holds good for GIS, because sometimes we are going to enlarge the map, sometimes we are going to reduce the map. So, you know, that topology concept has been picked up, well used here to define the relations between the objects. So what they have done, nothing great, what they introduced is, in a simple term you wanted, can tell you, they take the common boundary. Instead of treating the whole polygon as a polygon, you treat it, this is one arc, this is another arc. This arc is again common, this is another arc. Can I not say, this 1, 2 makes this polygon 64, minus 1, 3 makes this polygon 63. So what I am saying, plus 1 and minus 1. So I am tracing once like this, I am tracing this way other time. So with the direction when I put it the common arc, I can store the polygons with common boundary only once. That becomes possible. That is what the concept they introduced in topology. What they started doing it is, whenever they had to store the polygon features, they started defining a polygon as an arc of or a chain of segments. They started defining as a chain of segments, defining the common arc only once, telling which is the left polygon, which is the right polygon. How do we define the chain of segments to form a polygon? It is not only that, when the concept of topology came, they were able to even define a boundary which is interior within a boundary. Like, you know, there may be an island, there may be a water body within a village. When I work out about the land use and this water body area, I may like to subtract. So what happens? It becomes a whole. The polygon inside a polygon is a whole. In fact, even that they were able to define. And a polygon with multiple interior boundaries, it can have many holes in it, that was also defined. So topology was very well picked up, used. So they introduced topological concepts in a GIS, and you know, which improved a lot the method of storage. Because good contributions had been done again by the people who worked on research in US, especially first topology was implemented in their census data. They came with a coding called, you know, DIME. With that coding, they introduced to store their census tracts. Canada, some people worked to store their data, and which was adopted later by the GIS packages, so they introduced topology. But today, if you ask me, what is the latest development going on is, they are not much insisting on topology, but what they are insisting is, the common boundary must be same. They don't mind repeating the boundary, but they don't want unwanted polygon in between. Okay, common boundary will be, if you digitize today's in ArcGIS, you will see. It will track you and fill it. So common boundary can be same. They don't mind repeating it. They don't want to introduce noise in that common boundary. That's the way the trend has gone. So once you have a polygon with an arc of segments, naturally it gets defined even with an interior polygon in it, and then all attributes can be stored. And you know, you can get the data, you can immediately put the whatever the add-on attributes, put it in different tables, etc. All these things are possible. But whenever the topology has to be built, one has to keep in mind, whenever you digitize the data, once vector database is created, cleaning, editing and building topology have to be created. Done. It has to be done in case you want a clean common boundary between two of them, because errors, such these things may happen. See, suppose you have a segment which is hanging, which is not touching the boundary. How can it become a common boundary between two polygons? When you have an overshooting segment, where it will go, this part? So, you know, normally there are procedures to clean the data. If you are using a GIS tool, it provides it. So, cleaning, editing, a must. Because, see, in a GIS, what we are working, see, if you talk about accuracy in GIS, we talk about precision also. See, we work on 10th decimal and 11th decimal of a meter on the ground. That much we try to store the data. So even in a small segment, hanging is wrong. It won't accept it because it will compare both the nodes up to 10th decimal accuracy. So, you know, when you zoom, your data may look very good. When you zoom, you will see there will be a segment hanging. System will not allow you to go to the next step. So, you know, cleaning becomes a must, editing becomes a must. If your data is cleanly done without any error, topology gets built up automatically in the GIS tools which support topology. Okay? And, you know, once it is done, one can create the database, etc., etc. And just to talk about, since I spoke about the two data models, when do we go for raster, when do you go for vector? Because, you know, both have advantages, both have limitations. There are books which talk again, you know, putting big tables, they write, compare. What is raster? What is vector? Why should we go for raster? Why should we go for vector? Again, it depends on your case study. If you work for a, I'll say for an impact analysis of environment, or you are going for a natural resources application, which are the area where I have to cultivate paddy, that kind of question, you have to go for a raster. You are working for an alignment problem, a transportation problem, a location-based services problem, a service center problem, a telecommunication problem, you must go for vector. Okay? So wherever you try to use remote sensing data, try to go for raster. Wherever you go for a linear feature where your application is there, better go for vector. So, you know, both models are plus points and minus points. And today, every GIS handles both the models. Not like, you know, 12, 15 years back. Your GIS means it's a vector GIS, it's a raster GIS. Today everything is hybrid. You can switch over from here to there, that to here. So, you know, both have greatness. So, based on the application, user can choose. And of course, another model is TIN. TIN is an extension of vector model where people try to store the elevation data. Triangulated irregular network, we say, this is basically used for topographic data, elevation data, from which people can generate grid, DEM, digital elevation model can be generated, contours can be generated, slope and aspect can be generated, etc. TIN also is one of the models used for elevation data. Okay, and then comes after the spatial objects, then naturally our non-spatial attributes come into picture, where we try to store the non-spatial data. So, we try to store in using any one of the RDBMS tools. See, database management system is a software tool which handles the normally the tabular data. So in GIS, we try to pull the DBMS tool for handling the non-spatial data. Only thing is, there should be a link between your spatial object and the tabular data which you are storing. If there is a unique ID to your point, there will be that unique ID will be stored in your record in the table so that one can link it and query it. So RDBMS tools are used. One can go for the cheap RDBMS tool like, you know, MS Access. One can use the tool like Oracle. Based on the application, one can use for handling the non-spatial data. So whenever you try to store it, how do we link? Whenever you create, let me say, a point layer, I digitize the points. System will automatically create the table for you based on the DBMS you select, that point X, Y, it will give a system an ID, and whatever you are given as a user ID, well 1, well 2, if you say, it will also store. Moment that well 1, well 2 is there, you get all other attributes and store in it. So whether you are point or a line or a polygon, system will create a default table where you can append your own attributes and store it. Okay, and as far as the data collection for both the models are concerned, see, in GIS, one is hardware. Second is, okay, you buy the GIS software. Either you can go for, you know, millions of dollars software, you can go for cheaper software also, okay. And tool gives you all facility to do analysis, etc. But we all spend a lot of time and money on data. Because, you know, if you put noise, system will give you noise. If you put a good data, system will give you good result. Because it cannot think. So the thing is, much of time, money, labor, everything we spend in a GIS on data. Okay, see, once you do a primary survey, naturally, see, I work for Bombay, I say, I buy the latest remote sensing data, spending so many lakhs of rupees, naturally, my land use map will be very good. I go and borrow, okay, you have this MMID, I go take some data, somebody, I go take some data. Naturally, they would have done it using some method sometime. I have to be satisfied. So, one can do a primary survey, can do a secondary source data, but it depends again on the time and cost. And of course, if you go for raster, naturally remote sensing becomes the best source today as far as the ready raster is concerned. Similarly, vector, what we are all now trying to use is either a total station or a GPS, a geodetic receiver, you can take it, go and collect your locations, you can map the boundaries, take the data readily in vector form. So the data is possible as a primary source also, as a secondary source also, people can pull the data. The question is, quality. One has to keep in mind, if you depend on secondary sources, the certainty and the accuracy people who are using may not know. Okay. So we saw the data model about the spatial objects. Now we come to the analysis. Okay. So in analysis, when you say, normally what GIS can do it is, it can answer you, what is at a given location? Very simple. Go to a place, prick it, just it will say what is there. And you ask a query, show me the area where the rainfall had been greater than 700 millimeter, slope is less than 10 degrees, and you know there is a water body nearby, etc., etc. It can say. Or you are at this place and you want to find out the where is the closest market available, closest bank available. It closest bank or closest market, when I say, it need not be Euclidean distance. It will be actually on the road distance which you have to walk. It is not, you know, crow fly distance. System can actually tell you which is the distance available where you can reach. And, you know, you can do spatio-temporal modeling. Trends, how it has changed, how was earlier, how is today, how it may change tomorrow. One can do the analysis. And the wonder is, one can add any model with GIS. See, earlier days, you know, adding models in GIS was difficult. We used to take the data, put it out and do it and bring it back and all. Today, embedded models are possible. Why? Because, you know, the way the software has changed is, today GIS has become not only as a full-fledged tool, they give you as components. They give you as like kind of you consider like libraries. So you customize the whole thing for your application using those libraries plus whatever the model you want to do. You integrate it and make it as a full SDSS for you. So you know what happens if any model can be put so that the GIS with this functionality and your model can give the answer. Okay. So broadly speaking on spatial analysis, it can be categorized as queries, distance calculations, overlay, what you do, neighborhood operations, and the connectivity function. Connectivity function, we normally use what? For network analysis, shortest path finding, etc. So you can broadly categorize them into these categories. First, let us see the basics of raster operations. You have a raster data, let's say remote sensing data, or you have digitized, you have scanned, you have a map. First thing is what? You don't need to do any analysis. Simply you can use this as a display, like a digital cartography. Simplest is display the data. When I say display the data, there are many ways one can display. I show a map with colors with a legend. We have not done anything. We have just brought it to a scale, show it, put a north arrow with a legend and you can show. Or you can show in the display, in the visualization as a graded color. Suppose you are working on temperature. You can say high to low. Or you are working on elevation, DEM, low to high. or ranges of elevations can be stored. Or, you know, the third way is you can store just the contours alone, or you can show as a perspective view. Today again in GIS, there are modules available where you can fly through. You can animate it. You have the elevation data. You drape over it actual land use. And virtually you can fly through the area. That much is possible. Okay? Nothing. They all can be raster. So the first type is simple display. You do nothing, you can display the data. Second is, broadly speaking about raster, the way they categorize the operations are in three. Local, focal, zone. If you see the literature, they'll say the three broad categories, they run the operations as far as the raster is concerned. What is local? Local means I have supposed layers of data. If I run through pixel by pixel, one below the other, if I take fifth row, eighth column, in the next layer also fifth row, eighth column, next layer also fifth row, eighth column, I am going vertically down among the layers. That is a local operation. I am taking a layer, I am not bothered who is adjacent to me. I am going vertically down with multiple layers, pixel by pixel down. Like you have a multi-band data in remote sensing. You don't bother who is adjacent. You take a four-band as a vector and you process it. The same idea here, whenever you try to do the same position and go below on multi-layers, it is called as a local operation. Okay, in local operation, plenty can be done in GIS. Almost every raster GIS tool gives a lot of analysis. Simplest I'll tell you is map algebra. Map algebra, if you have seen, that is the simplest, which is very, very common in almost all raster GIS tools. People must have used probably IDRISI, ILVIS, GRAM++. Anybody has used, see, normally we all use it, the word map algebra. Map algebra is nothing. You have multiple maps, one sitting below the other. If it is 100 rows by 100 columns, this also must be 100 rows by 100 columns. Put one below the other. You can run the query, as I said, show me the areas where slope is less than 10 degree, rainfall is greater than 300 millimeter, the area has water body within 1 kilometer. You run all with an expression like if then, like we write a command, an instruction in a programming code. You run a long instruction, but instead of variable, here everything is a map. So you give a big algebraic expression with the maps, system will give you the answer which packet satisfy your query. So you know, map algebra is something which runs fully on a local operation, any number of layers possible, and you know, not only you run if then query, it can be algebraic, 5 star A plus 3 star B, where A is a map, B is a map. It can be algebraic, it can be arithmetic, it can be relational, it can be logical, it can be trigonometric. All operations can be run in a map algebra. When you have all layers sit in your thing, simply pull that map algebra module, give the expression. The operation is done using the local operations because it runs through the layers of pixels. I have simple example, I'll tell you. I have, let us say, monthly rainfall for this city. January, February, March, like that, 12 months ka I have. I want to get the map showing maximum. It will go through all the 12 pixel values in that, whichever is the maximum value, it will put it into your output pixel. For every pixel, it will maximize, find out and put it in your output pixel. So maximize is a common operation, minimize, average. So any number of layers, you can run it. Map algebra supports it, okay? So local operation, the best is map algebra, which people can use it to run n number of analysis functions, okay? It gives a generic tool, which people can use it. And of course, another thing is, normally we use the word overlay. Isn't it? In GIS, all of us use the word overlay because we all had pick this GIS from the idea of cartographer. Cartographer picks a map, puts one over the other, maps it. What our draftsmen used to do? Take that map, again put another map and map it. Same thing we are trying to do digitally. So overlay is again a common operation which people do it. So take a map, how many polygons are there? Take another map, put over it. Both will combine and give more polygons. That is also a local operation. Why local operation? Say, I have a polygon here with four squares and another polygon with diagonals. When I put one over the other, I get now many small, small polygons. And that area, it will say, from the first map, I have taken soil 1. From the second map, slope 1. So my new polygon contains the category soil and slope. Okay, so overlay is a common operation where people run it with two layers and combine the themes here and here and create a new map. And whenever it combines it, it creates a table also along with that, telling which theme and which theme had been combined to create the new. So, you know, system gives that detail also. So when you have local operation, well known is, one is, as I said, map algebra. Second is two maps overlay. Third is, there is something called conditional overlay. See, suppose you have two maps. Let me take again soil and slope. You have two categories of soil, two categories of slope. You know what you want to combine and give a new value as per your analysis. Beforehand itself, you can give. If this combination and this combination occurs, you give me new output value 1. Or you give me in the new map value 10. What you give, accordingly also it can run. So it can do overlay, conditional overlay, map algebra. All these things are all well-known operations and local. Okay, this is an example which shows us a local, I mean overlay done, unconditional overlay done between a taluka boundary map and a lithology map. And we saw local. Next I said is focal. Focal is nothing. I take a map. I single layer. Here it is not multiple layer. You have to keep in mind. In a single layer, I try to use my closest neighborhood to compute something. Okay, I don't know whether you might have had a lecture on remote sensing. What we do in remote sensing, we try to work on edge operator. How do we do edge operator? I run some filters. My gray value, I take my surrounding gray value, I have a convolution filter with which I try to run it and get the edges. Whenever there is a change of pixel value, it delineates the edges. Same way here, we can, when you have a neighbor, you try to use the adjacent 8 pixels or probably one more level. It can be 3 by 3, it can be 5 by 5. Take it, compute it and get your value. So in a GIS, what can be the best application for neighborhood? It can be, suppose I have the elevation data, I can use for calculating slope. So your focal operation, the best example is, of course you can smooth an image, you can run filtering and all, plus slope, aspect, etc. are computed in a GIS using focal operation where we take 3 by 3 neighborhood. Okay, how a slope is computed and all, I'm not covering the algorithm, but you can refer in any book. They give the formula. When you have an elevation, when you have 9, 8 elevations around you, you find out where your gradient is maximum among the difference of height. Get the tan theta, put that in your center pixel, or take the theta and put it. You get your slope map. Okay, for elevation, finding a slope is a focal operation in the perspective of GIS. So neighborhood operation can be filtering, smoothing the images, or you know, you can calculate slope. And what is aspect? Moment you get a slope map, in which direction your slope is following, that is what you try to store. It can be 0 degree, 45 or 90 or whatever it comes, you store. So a slope map can be generated from elevation data, an aspect map can be generated, a relief map can be generated. They are all neighborhood operation, which we call it as focal operation. So local is possible, focal is possible, and then comes extended neighborhood. Instead of just a 3 by 3 pixel, you can use, why not, suppose I have 100 rows by 100 columns, I am standing here. This is a location of a school, that is again a location of a school. You would like to find out in your map, who are all closer to you, so that this school can be used by this district boundary and that school can be used by those people living there. So you would like to make it, instead of only using the closest pixel, you are trying to use more pixels so that you can make a proximity map. So we are not only sitting with only one level pixel, we are going more. Another application of extended neighborhood is common operation we use in GIS is buffering. Buffering you never do with only one pixel. I have a road. I would like to protect 1 kilometer around the road or half a kilometer around the road. And your pixel may be, your resolution may be 30 meter. So how many pixels you need? Comes I come 30 pixels. So whenever you do a buffering, whenever you do a distance calculation, whenever you make a proximity map, they are all extended neighborhood operation. Extension of focal. Okay, because among that buffering is very, very common. Distance operations also. So buffering is one of the extended neighborhood operations in RASTRA. And of course, again, if you go through that, you know, they say, you know, visibility analysis. Sitting on the tower or putting a signal, how far the signal will go. You have an elevation data. Every pixel has an elevation. It is a digital elevation model. And you are starting on this, standing on the top of the tower. How much area is visible? It goes on all the 8 directions. And if there is a hindrance beyond it, it is not visible. So even viewshed mapping is an extended neighborhood operation. So one can do buffering, visibility, etc. using that. And then comes the zonal operation. Zonal is, you know, a lot of operations are possible. I just brought only one view graph to you. Zonal means, you know, what it does. See, I said neighborhood, focal and all done in a single layer. When I said local operation, number of layers can be many. When you come to zonal, it operates on 2 layers. One is a zone, another is a theme. You keep in mind, one is a zone, another is a theme. I can take an example of zone map, maybe a tehsil boundary map of a district. I have a map, well, say 10 tehsils are there. Each tehsil will have 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 3, 3. Assume as a raster map. A tehsil boundary map, and next is a, let us say, a rainfall map. It is a thematic map, this is a zone map. When I run a zonal operation, what it does, for every zone or for every cluster, it takes this value, finds minimum, maximum, average, whatever you want to calculate, and it stores in a table. So that moment you give a thematic map and an administrative boundary map, your table directly gives all the things about this theme in this zone. Okay, so automatically the zonal operation does it. So whether it is a rainfall you put or a elevation you put or whatever the attribute you put, the thematic map, it gets quantified. It is stored in a table for every zone. You can pull anything and make it a map or use it for any computation. Okay, that is what zonal operation does. Zonal operations compute a new value for each location of the existing values from a specified layer that are associated with the look, not only with the location itself, but with all the locations that occur within its zone. So it's not a local, a zone vis-a-vis a theme it works. Okay? So I have a zone map, a tehsil boundary map is shown. There I think elevation data is shown. So that moment this zonal map works with that elevation map, for each zone, it calculates the maximum value, minimum value, average, etc. Stores in a table for this theme. What are the theme it stores, and then it puts on a table. You can pull it and make a map for any attribute. Okay? So that is the concept of a zonal operation.
Can it be processed with vector as well as with the raster
method? You see, normally if you take, officially speaking, topo map, we are not supposed to digitize. That is one thing you have to keep in mind. No, none of us is authorized to digitize a topo sheet, except Survey of India, okay? Let us assume not topo sheet, any thematic map, okay? See, normally whenever you use a thematic map, the best way to do it is you vectorize it. Don't use it directly as a remote sensing data, scanned data. Vectorize it. After you cleaning, building and all, you rasterize to the resolution unit. That is the way you should use. Whether you are taking land use, or whether you are using contour, or whether you are using road network, you must digitize first in a vector mode, and then bring it to the, in case you are integrating remote sensing data, you come to the raster domain. In case you are using for a network analysis, keep it with the vector itself and you'll set. Okay.
Objects as points, lines or polygons.
Yes.
How will you print it as multi-polygon or multi-line?
Okay, please. Now, you look at in India, Andaman Nicobar. How many islands are there? Thousands of islands are there. Okay. Are they connected? No. They are all, as far as geometry is concerned, they are all disjoint polygons. Agreed? But are they, Government of India, will they give us the data for every small polygon? No. There is only one headquarter, Port Blair. If you want to store the non-spatial data, you have to store only as a single record. Fine? So what, that is the reason where they try to handle what is called as a multi-polygon. A multi-polygon, you have to see hierarchically upper than a polygon, where a multi-polygon is treated as a region. A region is consist of multi-polygon. You give a tree that what IDs of those polygons come to a region, region becomes one. For that region, you store the record. Okay, that is the way either a multi-polygon is treated, even a multi-segments are treated. See, I may be working on a national highway. On that highway, I am working in Gujarat and Karnataka, may not be in Maharashtra. The highway may be passing, some part in Gujarat, some part in Karnataka are to treat it. So there comes what? Multi arcs or multi segments. So you know, these are all got evolved by the people when they were doing applications. See, now like I'll show you afternoon vector models and vector analysis. Everything, you know, when people go to an application, that time you find, okay, our GIS doesn't handle it, we have to introduce it. In fact, multi-polygon concept was introduced by ESRA when they were handling Hawaii maps. Because Hawaii is part of US. When they had to handle, naturally they couldn't handle the data because there is again a single capital. So this concept was introduced, which now, as I said, latest OGC specification, they have taken care of very well. Not even, that's what I said, they have introduced something called multi-geometry, where points are possible, lines are possible, polygons are possible. So, you know, you build it, you give the link, and then treat it as a special object.
Then how will you distinguish between a polygon and a region?
It is different. Region means it is a separate category of objects. See, you cannot mix it. Point, you store it, you say it is the polygon as a feature. Okay, what is the geometry? It will ask you to treat it polygon. When you are saying region, you have to have a separate link hierarchically which polygons belong to them. Moment you define the region, that option is available.
So, region is a combination of polygon, multi-polygon, etc.
Absolutely. It may be joint, it may be disjoint. Moment you use the word multi-polygon, it is a collection of polygons, may be connected, need not be connected. That is the way it is generic. Okay.